Good news. In this video, we're going to get a chance to figure out what happened after the last cliffhanger where we were talking about reliability, and I realized that I wasn't going to get the reliability I needed. So I'm here with Sergio and Niels, who are going to help me with this. Please tune in. Welcome to the Azure Enablement Show, where we'll be discussing the challenges you and our other tech-savvy customers have encountered. Today, we'll be talking with experts to find out how they think about these problems, recommended tools and best practices, and tips they have learned from years of experience that you can use. So today, we're going to be discussing and diving deeper into Azure workload reliability. And in order to do that, I want to go back to where I was in the previous video, where I was in the middle of being a customer that had just learned something a little bit unsettling. So, Sergio, Niels, last time we talked, you had basically given me the not so great news that I had not architected in the way that I needed to get the level of reliability that I was hoping for. And I'm not so happy about that. What do I do now? I guess is the big question I have for you.
That's right. So we had a look at the architecture last time, and we came to the conclusion that you ended up with a 99.94% availability, where we were aiming for 99.99. So there are some things you can improve to increase this this availability, this composite SLA. So why don't we go over a few of the technical things? How's that sound?
Yeah. Yes, please.
Okay. So one thing we want to do to increase the availability is to add some redundancy to your solution. So in this case, you have one Kubernetes cluster. We would recommend in this case to have multiple, because in that case, it sounds obvious, if one of them breaks, the other one might be working. And to get them as far apart from each other as possible, you could put them in multiple Azure regions. So for example, you could have one in East US, one in South US, one in West Europe, one in North Europe, for example. And the thing here is that they would have to be identical. So that means that the deployment of these clusters themselves, as well as the containers that are on top of them, would need to be deployed in an automated way. So you would need to have your infrastructure as code in order, have all your code in repositories, build and release automatically to make sure that the two clusters in different regions are in fact identical, because a request that comes in might end up in either one of the regions. So one other thing to consider if you have multiple regions is that you also need to have your data layer available in both regions, because if the request can either end up in region A or in region B, the data that is available to serve those requests must also be so. So luckily, you're using Cosmos DB, which has a really nice capability where you have a multi-region write, so multi-master database. That means that any change you make to it in one region is automatically synchronized to the other region. And by enabling this capability, you also increase the availability of Cosmos DB itself. So that will really help you achieve the numbers you're looking for.
Okay. So it seems like, if I'm getting this right, I need to lean heavily into regions, and I need to lean heavily into fault tolerance through redundancy. But does that actually get me where I want to be? Is that enough?
Well, we can run the calculation in a minute. One other recommendation we have is, since you're using AKS for this solution, to enable availability zones. What that does is make sure that the cluster nodes you have are spread across different physical facilities in the Azure region, so that if there would be a facility-wide issue going on there, then the chance that your cluster is impacted is going to be less, because your workload is running in either of the facilities.
Okay, so that's really interesting. But Sergio, can I take this conversation in another direction? So one of the things that was a little disturbing to me about our outage is how we caught it and how we dealt with it. And I'm wondering if you have any advice around that.
Absolutely. Let's take a look at the Azure portal itself and work through an example of what this looks like when we make it real. Okay. All right. So very briefly, what I want to do is take a quick look at where you are now. Where are we starting from? And then how is that going to look different? And so in today's example, you essentially have your website running in a single region.
Right.
And we're going to go ahead and use Azure App Service as a stand-in for AKS, just so we can remove some of the complexities of all the containers that are running in your solution. But the observability and our reaction to failures is going to be exactly the same. Okay. So in today's world, you have your website running in one region. In this case, we placed this website in East US.
Okay.
And now in the event that something goes wrong, we're simply going to stop this website.
Yeah, okay.
Well, this is exactly what today's picture is for you. And today, if you had a problem in AKS, and in this place, we're simulating that, this is the experience that your customers have come to expect. You don't have any kind of redundancy. When there's a problem, you're just down.
Right.
So by moving into multiple regions, one of the things that we can do is we can say, okay, instead of running in just East US, let's run the web app in East US and West US. Okay. And what we talked about in the calculation is, in order to make this seamless for the customer, we need an additional component that you don't have today. We suggested in this case that Front Door might fit the bill. So Front Door is a global load balancer that is able to provide your customers a single website address like they have today. And it when they go to that address, Front Door is going to make a decision about which of those multiple website instances that we have now makes sense to go to. So in the very first panel, we now have a single website that we can visit. And in this next panel here, just very briefly, I want to show you where those two different websites are showing up. And so we have the concept of a backend pool. And essentially, this is all of the different regions. In this case, we only did two regions, just like in the calculation. But here they are. And so with these two websites now behind this one address, if we now go to your company website, then we find ourselves exactly where we started. We're in East US. However, now let's go back to the example that we created for your single region deployment. And let's go into one of your regions. So in this case, let's go into East US. Mm-hmm. And let's see what happens when we just stop it. Okay. And obviously, we're forcing sort of a worst case scenario. So when we go to stop this, the expectation is we should be in a better place. So we're now stopping the website. Let's go back to where we were. We reload the website. And oops, we still got an error message. Well, that's because even with something like Front Door in front of two websites, there's still a question of how long does it take to detect that there's a problem? How does it even detect that there's a problem? Well, there are health probes that are hitting the back end websites all of the time. And they're trying to determine, are you okay? Are you okay? And if you're okay, then I'll send customers there. Well, it takes a certain amount of time to determine that a website has gone away. And so if we now reload, we now find that enough time has passed that it realized that East US website was down in a catastrophic way. We just stopped it. Right. And now West US is now available. And so your customer is now able to continue their experience on your website because of now both redundancy of your websites as well as Front Door that sort of makes that transparent to your customers.
So what do I do to know when something's gone wrong, and what do I do about it when something goes wrong?
Sure. So at this point, you're going to have several options. All of the individual services have their own logging and their own metrics that you can leverage to make those decisions. So why don't we go ahead and just take a look at Front Door itself?
Okay.
So Front Door itself keeps track of all of those times when nodes were healthy and unhealthy. And let's just take a graphical look at it. all of this is available to be queried, and you can, you know, you can write complex queries around it. But just graphically, we can see that we've received some requests, no surprise there. We can even break it down by backend. So we're seeing some requests are going to one region, and this different color indicates we're going to a different region. But now we can also look at backend health. So this is one visualization, but what this should represent to you is that you now have data that can be queried, and you can create alerts around this information to be able to know and either be notified or even take action when one of these regions drops out. And so if you see this orange region, this was region A or East US. When we stopped it, that's what it looked like. Yep. And so now you have visibility into when these outages are occurring.
So presumably I shouldn't just stare at graphs all day long. To find out when something's wrong, like having people with eyeballs on graphs doesn't seem like a good use of people's time. What can I do instead?
Absolutely. So one of the things that you can do is you can leverage built-in alerts for a given service. Now, again, we're sitting inside a front door, which might just be one portion of your application. But in here, what we can do is we can create a new alert and base it on any condition that we'd like. So in these conditions, I talked about the fact that we have lots of different metrics, lots of different activities to choose from. And so we can go through and understand, and these are the same. So we looked at backend health percentage as an example. This is the same kind of thing that we can leverage now to build out reactions. So here's that same kind of graph to kind of confirm what we're looking at. There is some sophistication you can build into this. And so if you're wanting to consider a window of time, versus just outage happened, you know, kind of logic, you can use this alert logic to implement that. And once you've done that, and you've specified a condition that makes sense for what you're trying to track, you have several options for actions. So for actions, you can do the more traditional alerting, as it were. And I need to plug a value in here. You can just alert somebody, alert that human, as you mentioned. Or you can take advantage of several other types of actions. So action groups can include notifications, but they can also include things like executing a runbook or an Azure function. And so if you have had enough experience with this solution to know how to resolve a particular kind of problem, you can automatically resolve them with actions that are specified in this action group, and not just have to send the page or send the text message to the technician who would have to go fix it themselves.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of letting computers do what computers do and people do what we need people to do. So I think that's really great. Okay, so I have one last question to ask you that's been sort of nagging me this whole time as been talking about this. I really appreciated our chance to look over failure mode analysis and be able to figure out, you know, what could fail and how often and come up with composite SLAs and stuff like that. But I just have this sense like that's a really good way and an important, and the first thing we have to do is figure out that which we know could go wrong and plan for it. But I'm also, well, based on my recent experience with this outage, really quite aware that there's stuff that I know that I don't know. And so what do I do about the things I don't know about, if the failure modes that I couldn't have anticipated?
You're absolutely right to identify that every exercise that we've done so far has relied on you anticipating a potential future.
Right.
But the reality is, as you sense, this is really just the beginning of a long-term learning process. And there's several ways that we can learn as far as continuing to evaluate the reliability of our solution. One of them, and probably the least effective, but unfortunately sometimes most common, is that we can simply wait around. We can wait for something else to happen, another outage, another unexpected failure. Not a great way to do it, but it is something that will always be with you. There will always be the unexpected, but we can do better than that. One of the things that you saw me demonstrate in showing you the value of a multi-region deployment is we can simulate failures. We can force failures. Mm-hmm. And so, you know, I also encourage you to look at the components that you are using and figure out, like in the case of AKS, you know, can we just stop containers and see what happens? See if our plans are meeting reality. Are we detecting it as we planned we would? Are we being able to react to it automatically if that was something that we planned for? So forcing failures is a great way to kind of double check the design work.
Okay.
It doesn't have to stop there, though. One of the things you can also do is take a more experimental model. That is something that, you know, looks a lot closer to the scientific method, where we form an idea, a hypothesis, and then we just try it out. And oftentimes we try out that hypothesis in our production environment. Now, before we go into anything like that from an experimentation perspective, what becomes super critical is that we have put in place the ability to observe our solution as fully as possible. Because otherwise, if we're just experimenting our environment, we won't have any way to know what is happening. And that's kind of just causing chaos. And chaos is a funny word, because there is actually a branch of engineering called chaos engineering, where it's the idea that once we properly instrument our solution, we can introduce real world scenarios just at random, just chaotically, and see how our solution organically responds. See how our processes, you know, that meet our solution responses, see how those line up. And so we can design experiments and go through and do that. We also have things like game days as another type of exercise, where again, we set up a scenario. You know, oftentimes we have teams in those kinds of scenarios where, you know, maybe in a retail setting like yours, we might have one team generating unpredictable load, or, you know, exercising your website in unusual ways. You know, and perhaps at scale, perhaps automation is a part of that as well. And then another team that is essentially responding to that. Do we have, are we seeing the monitoring alerts come through? Are we seeing the automatic actions? And so we can really design these experiments to basically validate that all the design work and all of the, you know, everything we've tried to do is basically resulting in the target, meeting the targets that we had specified at the beginning of this exercise.
So that makes total sense to me. So I could talk about this stuff with you all day, this reliability stuff, because this is really interesting. And I really appreciate you taking the time to look over my stuff. And you and Niels have been super helpful. I want to thank you for that. I really appreciate it. I think probably I have to go back to host mode. Well, that was really cool. I'm glad to have a chance to talk with Niels and Sergio about reliability, but we have to end here. I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope it's been useful to you. Thank you much. Thank you for joining us, and I hope you'll watch some of the other videos in this series. Take care, and we'll talk to you a little bit later on.